కూజంతం రామ రామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం యత్ర యత్ర రఘునాథ కీర్తనం తత్ర తత్ర కృత మస్తకాంజలిం బాష్పవారి పరిపూర్ణలోచనం మారుతిం నమత రాక్షసాంతకం వైదేహీ సహితం సురద్రుమతలే హైమే మహామంటపే మధ్యే పుష్పకమాసనే మణిమయే వీరాసనే సుస్థితం అగ్రే వాచయతి ప్రభంజనసుతే తత్వం మునిభ్యః పరం వ్యాఖ్యాంతం భరతాదిభిః పరివృతం రామం భజే శ్యామళం. ద రామాయణ సిరీస్ పార్ట్ 43. హూ ఇస్ నాట్ అ సిన్నర్? దట్స్ ద టైటిల్ ఆఫ్ టుడే. వన్స్ ద మైటీ రావణ వాస్ డిఫీటెడ్ ఇన్ బ్యాటిల్ బై రామ. ది వార్ between the great monkey forces and the ogre forces came to an end. The way Rama slew Ravana was something that nobody had seen before. Uttama amartalam amittador eril tanu vittakanayal attiravarakkan mudipattum urukottana udirtha tiralon, says Swami Deshikan. Rama beheaded the bunch of heads of Ravana at one go using the great missile given by Rishi Agastya to him. Now, after the fall of Ravana, his brother Vibhishana lamented over the loss of his elder brother. This Vibhishana had left the side of Ravana in order to come and serve Rama because he knew that righteousness was with Rama and he was a Dharmatma. But when he actually saw his brother having fallen down on the battlefield like this, he couldn't control his emotions and he went, hugged his brother and lamented over the great loss. Soon the consorts of Ravana too came to know of his demise and they all came to the battlefield headed by the primary consort of Ravana, Mandodari. Mandodari lamented over the loss of her husband with a lot of wisdom, it is said. Mandodari felt bad that he was no more, but she felt more bad that he had not listened to the advice of so many good people around him. There were so many people who hinted that this kind of a war would ensue and that would lead to his disaster. And this could be avoided by just returning back Sita to Rama. But he just did not pay heed to any of their advices. And here was the consequence in front of her eyes. So when she lamented, she called out to Ravana and said that, "How I wish, my lord, you would have listened to the words of the wise Maricha, who refused to assist you in this project of abducting Sita initially. How I wish you would have listened to the wise words of your brother Vibhishana, who tried to pacify you as much as he could. And when he couldn't, he decided to leave your side and go to the right side. How I wish you would have listened to the advice of your immediate brother Kumbhakarna, who too spoke only for your good. But since you did not listen, he decided to still be by your side for the sake of brotherhood. How I wish you would have listened to your own grandfather Malyavan, and how I wish you would have listened to the wise words of Hanuman, who came as the messenger of Rama that day and told you to return Sita back to Rama. Had you listened to any of these good words, you would not have been in this state today." And she also added a beautiful statement saying that, "I can understand Rama to be Lord Narayana himself. Tamasah paramodhata shankhachakra gadadaraha. I understand that he is the cause of the universe, bearing the shankha and the chakra. He has the Srivatsa mole in his chest and he is the one who has auspiciousness always with him. So that glory of victory was definitely going to be his. Even after looking at him, oh my lord, why did you not realize that you could not win the war? You should have at least thought of returning back Sita to Rama after having met him for the first time in the battle, when he told you to rest well and return soon. Saying all these different things, Mandodari lamented over the loss of Ravana. And after this, it was time for performing the last rites of Ravana. Now, Vibhishana, who initially cried over the loss of his brother, now settled himself and he came back to his normal state of mind, which was only devoted to righteousness. So now he thought that this man who was supposed to be his brother was actually his enemy, because he was the enemy of his Lord Rama, the Lord who was the very embodiment of righteousness. So he did not feel like performing the last rites of Ravana, and there was no other kinsman of Ravana remaining to perform his last rites. So Vibhishana told Rama that I do not want to perform the funeral of my brother, because I can't consider him as my own brother. He was so much against righteousness that he was okay with driving me away from the kingdom, and he was okay to come back and fight with you even after you had given him one last chance of improving himself. How can I have any attachment with this person and go ahead to perform some rite which is performed only by near and dear ones? To this, Rama laughed and replied that, Vibhishana, what you think of is really respectable. Your commitment to righteousness is to be respected. But please understand that Ravana was what he was when he was. Now he is not at all there. He ceased to exist. So why keep any enmity against him? Or why even think of the enmity that he had towards me? It's all over now. And you should not think like this. You should not think ill of one who has ceased to exist. With him, his enmity is also gone. And he was your brother by birth. So you ought to perform his last rites for my sake. He is as well mine as he is yours. These were the words of Rama. He said, Kriyatamasya samskaro mama apyesha yathatava. He is as well mine as he is yours. So, if you consider me as your own, then my Ravana is also your brother. He is as well mine as he is yours, says Rama. Who can say such exorbitantly magnanimous words? Only the greatest of lords can say such things. This kind of broad-mindedness, this kind of abundant mentality comes only to big people. Big people means people who have a big heart. And Rama had the biggest of hearts to accept his enemy as his own kin, and advised Vibhishana that for my sake, you have to perform the last rites of Ravana. Listening to these kind words of Rama, Vibhishana's heart melted and he went ahead to perform the last rites of his brother. After this was done, Vibhishana was installed onto the throne of Lanka by Lakshmana. Now, one thing that is to be noted is, even Sugriva was installed on the throne of Kishkindha by Lakshmana. And now Vibhishana was also installed by Lakshmana. Rama wanted Lakshmana to do these things, it seems, for two reasons. One was, he was an exile under an oath. So he had promised not to enter the limits of a city, not to cross the boundaries of a city and enter it. That's the reason why he did not enter either Kishkindha or inside the city of Lanka. The war happened in the fortress area outside Lanka, which was meant for war. And so, even for the consecration of Vibhishana, Rama decided not to get into the city, but he made Lakshmana do the required ceremony. And Rama wanted Lakshmana to do it with his auspicious hands, it seems. Because Lakshmana was the one who was an embodiment of auspiciousness. Lakshmano Lakshmi Sampannaha, it is said. Lakshmana is the one who had Lakshmi with him, who had auspiciousness with him always. Because he had the greatest of auspiciousness, which was the wealth of service, Kaimkarya Shri. And so anything that Lakshmana would touch would turn into gold. And that is why Rama wanted his dear friends Sugriva and Vibhishana to be installed on the throne by Lakshmana, and that is what happened. Once Vibhishana was installed on the throne, Rama sent a message with Hanuman to Sita. He told Hanuman to go and tell Sita that now there is no reason for her to worry because Ravana had been defeated by him and he had come to Lanka to end all her troubles. It is said that Hanuman very enthusiastically flew to the Ashokavana to meet Sita. And this time when he flew to the Ashokavana, he was respected by all the augurs. The last time he had come to visit Ashokavana, he had to do it so secretively. But now, with all might and pride, he flew across the city of Lanka to the Ashokavana, being respected by all the Rakshasas as he passed through. And when he reached Ashokavana, he saw Sita in the same sad state that she was in, because she was subject to so much of tension during the war. She was actually taken to the battlefield by Indrajit to show the serpent bound bodies of Rama and Lakshmana. So she was still in a very troubled state of mind. But when she saw Hanuman, her heart jumped with joy, because seeing Hanuman himself was very auspicious for her. Because she knew that Hanuman would come with some good message for her, with some happy message for her. And that exactly was what Hanuman had to say. Hanuman told Sita about Rama's victory over Ravana and that her troubles were all soon to end now. And he asked Sita as to what message he had to take back to Rama. At this time, Sita Devi was so overwhelmed with joy that she couldn't speak for a few minutes. And after that, with a very choked voice, she told Hanuman, "I can think of nothing on earth which is worthy of you or comparable to the act of communicating this beautiful news to me. Nahi pashyami sadrisham chintayanti plavangama akhyanakasya bhavato datum pratyabhinandanam." What can I give you in return? You can be given the lordship of the worlds, all the riches in the worlds. Even that would not be enough for what you have done for me. What a news you have come and given me. So saying, Sita was in tears of joy. To this, Hanuman replied that, "My dear mother, the very words that you have said, the words of gratitude that you have expressed to me, who is a servant of yours, is everything for me. The affection that is there in your words means much, much more than all the riches in the world or even the lordship over the worlds. Tavaitat vachanam saumye saravat snigdhamevacha." The very meaningful and affectionate words that you have spoken mean everything to me. Saravat snigdhamevacha, he says. Your words have a lot of meaning, laden with meaning, sara, and is also laden with affection, snigdha. Saravat snigdhamevacha. This is more than anything in the world for me. Ratnaughat vividhat chapi devarajyat visishyate. It's more than riches or even lordship over the worlds for me. But my dear mother, if you permit me, I would certainly like to do one thing. Sita asked what? To this, Hanuman very gleefully replied, "If you permit me, I will kill all these notorious ogresses by whom you have been intimidated in the past. I have seen how cruelly they troubled you at that time when you were in the Ashokavana, the last time that I visited you. I wish to kill them by means of strokes of my fist."
I wish to pounce at these cruel, extremely violent and deformed ogresses who have such distorted features like terrible hair and eyes. I wish to kick them with my long feet and I wish to bite them with my teeth, breaking off their ears and nose and pulling out their hair. Please grant this boon to me. Now, as Hanuman went on describing the way he wanted to torment these ogresses got so scared. The very way he was describing was absolutely terrorizing for them. And with scared eyes, they looked at Sita. They were just waiting to hear her reply. They wished that she would not say yes to Hanuman. And knowing Sita, that's exactly what she did. Sita told Hanuman, Hanuman, see, I understand your affection and concern towards me, but this is not the way you must react. Who are these ogresses? They are but the servants of Ravana, and they have come here only on his command to do whatever he has told them. So they troubled me when Ravana was alive. Now that Ravana has been defeated in battle, they are no longer going to have anything to do with me, leave alone trouble me. So, by being servants, they obeyed the command of their master. For that matter, even you are a servant of your master Rama and you are obeying his command. If one is to be punished for obeying his master, then I think all servants can be punished for the same. That is not done. So, these ogresses personally have not done any wrong towards me. They have just obeyed the commands of their master. So, they do not wish any such treatment from you. Moreover, long back in this very Ashoka Grove, after you visited me and went, these ogresses tried to trouble me again and again. And Trijata, one of the ogresses who was the daughter of Vibhishana, came and spoke to me, consoled me and asked something of me. She said, I know that one day your Lord Rama will come and defeat Ravana. And on that day, all these ogresses who have been troubling you will be at your mercy. So I pray that they should not be punished by you then. I remember the surrender that Trijata made to me that day. I cannot let down somebody who has surrendered to me. This was uttered by the wife of Rama, who said, Sakradeva prapannaya tavasmiti chayachate abhayam sarva bhutebhyo dadamyetad vratam mama. If one surrenders once to the Lord, he never ever leaves them unattended. And that's exactly what Sita Devi also did. And she told a small story to Hanuman to support her point of view. She told Hanuman that there was once a tiger who ran in pursuit of a hunter. And the hunter climbed up a tree. A bear was already perched on that tree. Now, the tiger was standing at the foot of the tree and he told the bear that, see, both of us are living in the forest and the hunter is our common enemy. So you now knock him down from the tree and I will eat him and I'll go away. But the bear replied, having reached my abode, the hunter is one who has sought asylum with me. In a way, he has sought asylum with me by climbing on the tree where I reside. So it is my duty to protect him and I am not going to hurl him down. I will be deviating from my duty if I do so. So saying so, the bear went off to sleep. And after a while, the tiger who was still standing down saw the hunter awake and the bear asleep. So he told the hunter that now you push the bear down and I will spare you. I'll eat the bear instead of you. The hunter was so thankless that he pushed the bear down. But on his way of being pushed down, the bear suddenly got up and he caught hold of another branch of the tree and he sat there. Now the tiger who was watching from down told the bear that, see what the hunter has done to you. Though you saved him at the time of his danger, he failed to protect you. I told him to push you down and he did that without a second thought. So now I tell you, you go and push the hunter down and save yourself. You don't have to worry about this ungrateful person. Even at that time, the bear said that, sorry, I cannot
betray the hunter even though he betrayed me. Because having come to my tree, he has sought asylum from me, and I shall protect the one who has sought asylum from me. That way, if one surrenders to another, he becomes responsible for protecting him throughout. This was shown by the bear. Now, if animals can practice this kind of faithfulness to surrender, then why not we? Trijita has surrendered on behalf of the Rakshasis to me, and I need to save them now from you. And to top it all, my dear Hanuman, all of us go wrong somewhere. Papanam va shubhanam va vadharhanam plavangama karyam karunamaryena nakaschinna aparadhyati. Who is the one who is not a sinner? Who has not done wrong in the past? Whoever is it would have a past which has a mistake. So it's very natural to go wrong in life. And if these ogresses have done some wrong, it is with a reason. And even if it has been done without a reason, they deserve to be saved by me because they have surrendered. Papa namva, shubha namva, whether they are sinners or whether they are good people, or even if they are the ones who are fit to be slain, vadharhanam plavangama, we need to show compassion to the one who has surrendered to us. Karyam karunamaryena, finally, who is the one who has never sinned? Nakaschinna paradhyati, says Sita Devi, the ocean of compassion. And thus, by showing this kind of compassion towards those ogresses who tormented her so much in the Ashoka Grove, Sita Devi rose high in the esteem of all of them, and also in the eyes of all of us today who read this episode or who tell this episode or who listen to this episode. So that's the principle of the mother of the universe, Sita Devi. Who is not a sinner? So everyone deserves to be saved. So with the grace of this Sita Devi, we are all sure to be saved. What happened further in the story, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namatarakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 44, Purity Personified. That's the topic of this part. After having defeated the mighty Ravana, Rama got Vibhishana coronated as the king of Lanka at the hands of Lakshmana. And then Hanuman was sent to Sita with the message of Rama that the enemy had now been defeated and that all her troubles were over. Sita was overjoyed to listen to this news, and she in turn told Hanuman that she was waiting to go and have a look at her lord. When Hanuman came back with this exciting news to Rama, Rama was overjoyed and he said that Sita may be brought to his presence. Now here one thing that we need to observe is Hanuman played the role of a duta or a messenger between Sita and Rama not once but twice. And at both the times, he was successful not only in his mission, but also in giving extreme happiness to the hearts of Sita and Rama. So the second time when this messenger Hanuman came back with his news, Rama felt overwhelmed all over again that he was now actually going to see Sita. He was so happy. So he told Vibhishana to bring Sita after she had a good bath, decorated herself with nice clothes and wearing ornaments. He wanted Sita to feel good after 10 months of utter torture at the Ashokavanam. So he told Vibhishana to go to Sita and offer her all this service of decking herself up and then bring her back to his presence. Vibhishana went accordingly and submitted to Sita after bowing down to her what the wish of Rama was. Sita first denied to have any bath. She said, I wish to see my lord as it is. I just want to go and see him. I do not want any delay in this meeting with my lord. But Vibhishana insisted that it was the wish of Rama and it would be good for her to obey that. So Sita did agree and she was given a very royal bath by the ogresses and she was decked up with a very expensive dress and ornaments made of shining gold. It is said that she came with a beautiful red sari and was shining in gold with her large beautiful eyes, curly black hair. She was brought in a palanquin to the presence of Rama. As this palanquin was proceeding towards Rama, all the monkeys and all the remaining ogres were all eager to see Sita. So they all rushed towards the palanquin, making a big crowd. There was a lot of hue and cry. And Vibhishana's men tried to drive away the crowd so that the palanquin could move peacefully. Rama saw this and he got a little annoyed, it seems. He said, why are you doing this? All these people want to see Sita. And who are they? They are my people. Janoyam swajano mama, he says. They're all my people wanting to see Sita. What's wrong in that? Let them all have a look. In fact, why this palanquin? Let Sita come down from the palanquin, walk and come towards me so that all of them can have a good look at Sita. After all, they all have fought for her sake, so they deserve to see her. Let them see to their heart's content. Let her get down, walk and come. So in obedience to the command of Rama, Sita got down from the palanquin and started walking towards him. As Sita was approaching Rama, his expression on the face turned from joy to that of disregard. Suddenly his face changed and also his tone of speech. When Sita came and stood in front of him, she was just waiting to see her lord and her eyes were full of affection. But Rama had a stern look and a sterner voice. And he told Sita, you stand here one back by me after conquering the enemy on the battlefield. This was worth doing because I had to clear off the bad name attached to me because of your abduction. Whatever disgrace had come to me because of losing my wife has now completely gone because I have defeated the enemy and won you back. My manliness has been witnessed by everybody today. Whatever wrong that was done to you by Ravana has been punished. And that laudable achievement of the celebrated Hanuman in shape of leaping across the sea, devastating Lanka, all that has borne fruit today. The exertion of Sugriva, who exhibited all his prowess on the battlefield along with his army, that has rendered fruit today. Similarly, the exertion of Vibhishana, who came and sought my presence, deserting his own brother, has gained fruit today. So all these things have become fruitful today because you stand one by me. But please understand that all this exertion in the shape of a war, which has been successfully carried through, all thanks to the prowess of my friends, the monkeys and Vibhishana, were not undertaken for your sake. Viditaschastu bhadram te yoyam rana parishramaha sutirna suhridam viryan na tvadartham maya kritaha. All this was not done for your sake. All of these things that I have enlisted now, the feats of Hanuman, Sugriva, Vibhishana and my own, were all not for your sake. What were they for then? They were to remove the disgrace that I had because my wife had been stolen, and to prove to the world that if somebody is unrighteous, the king will come and punish him. That was the only reason why I came to redeem you. Not for your sake. Oh my God. Sita's heart sank listening to this. Her wide eyes were bathed with tears. She did not understand why her lord, who was so sweet in his speech, who had never ever uttered a harsh word to her before, was speaking like this. He was speaking in a tone that she had never heard before, and he was speaking words that she had never even thought of before. He went ahead to tell her that, "I cannot stand your presence in front of me. Please do not stand in front of me. It feels like a person having a sore eye is looking at a lamp. If a person has any kind of an eye infection and if he looks at bright light, then he's not able to see it. He wants to close his eyes. Similar is my state. I do not want to look at you. For me, you are like the lamp which is being looked at by a person having sore eyes. Deepo netra turasyeva pratikulami medrida." These sharp arrow-like words pierced the ears of Sita and also her heart. Her body was shaking and she was drenched in tears. After a while, she wiped her tears and spoke to Rama. She said, "Rama, why do you address to me like a common man? You are a hero. Such unkind, unbecoming words, which are uttered only by common men, do not suit you. I am not any ordinary person. Neither are you any ordinary man. So why are you behaving like a commoner to me? How can you have this distrust on me despite our having lived together for so many years? If you did not trust me, then why did you not tell that to Hanuman who came as your messenger that day to me, to the Ashoka Grove? Had Hanuman told me that you do not have any more trust remaining in me, then I would have very well given up my life then and there. Then all this exertion that you're talking about, the exertion of war, would have never happened. Why did everything have to bear fruit the way you were enlisting it? It was totally unnecessary. All the exercise that you have done is completely futile if you do not have trust on me. If you did not do all this to win me back, then why at all did you win me back? Why all this trouble that you took and troubled your friends, the monkeys and Vibhishana too?" Speaking all these words with a choked voice, with tears, weeping all the while, Lakshmana was then addressed to by Sita. Sita called out to Lakshmana and told him that, "Lakshmana, now you raise a fire for my sake. My husband does not trust me anymore. There is no use of my living. Let me enter into the fire." So saying, she prostrated, circumambulated Rama and told Lakshmana to light a fire, which he was a little hesitant about. Then she reminded Lakshmana that she was like Sumitra to him, like his own mother, and he had to abide by her command. Listening to which, Lakshmana did light a fire, and Sita circumambulated that fire too and entered into it, saying the following words. She said, "As my heart never turns away from Rama, I know the God of fire will protect me from all sides. If I have been faithful to Rama by word and action, then let this God of fire protect me from all sides. If it is true that I am pure of character, and if this is known to the glorious sun god, the deities who preside the four quarters of the world, and to the moon god, then let this fire protect me from all sides." Saying all these words, she entered into the blazing fire, and all the monkeys and the ogres were watching. They were all crying out loud as Sita entered the fire. Nobody could watch this terrible scene in front of their eyes. They thought Rama would stop her. But Rama chose to be ignorant to the entire episode. What was happening? This Rama, whom we were talking so highly about all this while, is talking so wrong about his wife and actually watching her enter the fire without stopping her in front of his eyes? Why did we even regard him so much? There were so many doubts arising in the minds of everybody who were watching this scene. It is said that even the gods were unable to watch this scene without reaction. They all came running down. Everybody came down in their chariots and tried to ask Rama what was happening. Why was Rama ignorant to this situation? And at that time, the fire god came in person and returned back Sita to Rama. He said, "Oh Rama, don't you know your spouse Sita? She is this blessed lady whose conduct is excellent, who has never been unfaithful to you, who is endowed with the strength of character, and by word and mind, again, even by conception or by glance, she is always only yours. How could you suspect her? You must accept the sinless princess of Mithila, who has an absolutely untainted mind. I give her back to you. She entered my kingdom, the kingdom of fire. I cannot have her with me because she is more scorching than me because of her purity. She is purity personified. Please take her back." When these words were said by the god of fire, Agni, to Rama, Rama said, "Of course, I know how pure my Sita is." Now the tone of Rama came back to normalcy. And it is said that he had tears in his eyes when he said these words. "I know Sita, the daughter of Janaka, the princess of Mithila, has undivided affection for me and me alone. But she had to undergo this purificatory ordeal for the sake of the world, so that the world would not murmur against our clan, the Ikshvaku race, my father Dasharatha. They would have probably raised issues, murmuring against us, saying that Rama was really foolish that he accepted his wife who lived in the house of another man for 10 months. So just to satisfy the world's point of view and the unnecessary comments that they would pass on my dynasty and clan, I decided to do this purificatory ordeal. And know that Sita has never been separated from me in reality. Ananya himaya Sita bhaskarena prabhayatha." Rama says, "Sita and myself are like the sun and its radiance. We can never be separated from each other. So this entire drama of separation was done with a purpose to defeat unrighteousness. And now, even this drama of the purificatory ceremony was done just to show to the world that if a person in an important position has to himself undergo some trouble, he should do that for the sake of satisfying the world around him." That's why when Rama made a comment to Sita that for him she was like a lamp which was perceived by the one who had a sore eye. So in this very example, the lamp was Sita and the one having the sore eye was Rama. So the fault was in the beholder, not in what was being seen. If a lamp cannot be seen by a one with sore eyes, then whose fault is it? Is it the fault of the lamp or the one with the sore eye? So here the fault was Rama's. He should not have suspected Sita. But he acted as if he was suspecting Sita because this kind of suspicion would probably be there in the minds of other people who would be part of his kingdom later on. And to satisfy the minds of all these people, he acted as though he himself had the suspicion and made Sita undergo this purificatory ceremony, so that she would be stamped as purified before Rama accepted her. In this way, he was also protecting Sita from a possible bad name that she could have got. So this was only the sacrifice of Rama where he proved to the world that his wife Sita was purity personified. That this entire episode was a drama, and that Sita too had her complete acceptance in participating in this drama has been suggested by Swami Deshikan in his Mahavira Vaibhavam. He says, Swa samaya sughatita vighatita sahrdaya sahadharma charinika. He says that it was the wish of the Lord, the sankalpa of the Lord, to be associated and dissociated with Sita as a drama, sughatita vighatita. And Sita decided to play this role of being his partner both during the time of union and at the time of separation, because she was his sahadharma charini. Janaka had told Rama that Sita would be his sahadharma charini. Sahadharma charitava yam Sita mamasuta sahadharma charitava, he had said. So Sita decided to play the role of a heroine in the drama that Rama had organized in order to prove to the world as to how a human being, how a king should live. A king should live satisfying the minds of his people, of his subjects. So, in order to dispel any doubt in the mind of his subjects and also to preserve the good name of his wife, he himself underwent a lot of criticism by people surrounding him, where he took over the role of playing a suspicious husband. And he ordered for this fire sacrificial ceremony, out of which Sita came out purity personified. Once Sita came out, she was united with Rama, and all the gods surrounding now started hailing the victory of Rama. How they did that, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 46. The coronation. This is the grand title of today's story. Rama defeated the mighty ogre Ravana and got Vibhishana coronated as the king of Lanka. Following that, he was united with Sita after he proved the purity of Sita to the world. Following this, all the devas from the heavens came down and hailed Rama for his victory. They sang his praises. And everybody present in that assembly was overjoyed with this victory of Rama. And they were all in a celebrating mood. But Rama was in a hurry to return back to Ayodhya. Vibhishana invited Rama into his palace so that he could come have a bath, decorate himself with good clothes and ornaments, have good food and rest, and then leave for Ayodhya. After all, he had achieved such a big feat and he had been living the life of sages for 14 years. So Vibhishana thought that Rama now deserved some kind of rest and luxury. But Rama told Vibhishana that, my dear Vibhishana, I stand honored by you for your most valued hospitality and affection, but I cannot accept this offer of yours for two reasons. One, I am still on exile. I have not completed my period of exile and gone back to Ayodhya. So I cannot accept any of the pamperings that you're offering to me. Secondly, even if I were permitted to accept these offerings, I would not like to do so, because my dear brother Bharata is waiting for me, living the life of an ascetic. He just wants me to return back to Ayodhya. And he had come all the way to Chitrakuta to take me back. And he had begged me to come back. But I did not grant his prayer. Though he besought me with his head bent low, I could not grant him what he asked for. But I promised that I would come back after my term of exile is over. And now it's time for me to keep up my promise. I just have one thing to ask of you, my dear friend Vibhishana. If I walk back to Ayodhya, it's going to take a long time. And the tenure of my exile is coming to an end very soon. So I may not be able to reach Ayodhya before the tenure of my exile if I walk and go. So if you could give me some means of transport which will take me quickly to Ayodhya, I would really feel happy. To this, Vibhishana bowed down to Rama and said, I completely understand your feeling, Rama. I shall enable you to reach the city of Ayodhya in the course of a single day. There is a heavenly and excellent aerial car called Pushpaka Vimana, which was actually used by Ravana to abduct Sita. But it's an excellent vehicle and it belongs to my half-brother Kubera, the ruler of Yakshas. Ravana had once stolen it from Kubera and had kept it with himself since then. Today, I understand that this Pushpaka Vimana is actually here in Lanka to serve this purpose of yours. It is here to transport you back to Ayodhya on time without any trouble. So you can easily reach very soon. So I pray again that you please come and at least have some food and rest before you go. Rama very politely refused his offer and said, if you really insist that we should all come and accept your hospitality, I would suggest that you give this feast and attention to all the monkeys here who have fought on my behalf. They certainly deserve a feast. They certainly deserve to be pampered with gifts. So if you can do something for the monkeys, something to keep them relaxed and happy, I would be more than happy. Vibhishana himself had a very hospitable heart, and so he happily invited the monkeys because it was something that was going to please Rama in addition to his own hospitable nature. So he called all the monkeys and gave them a huge feast and bestowed special honors on them. Once this was done, Rama was ready to leave in the Pushpaka Vimana. He, along with Sita and Lakshmana, boarded the Vimana, it seems. And just before he boarded, Rama called Sugriva and told him that I'm really thankful to you, my dear friend, because this great job could have never been accomplished without your help. So now, after having discharged your duty as a friend, you please return back to your kingdom of Kishkindha and rule well. So also he called Vibhishana and told him the same. He told Vibhishana to rule over Lanka wisely and took leave of him. At this juncture, Vibhishana submitted to Rama that, O Rama, we also desire to proceed to Ayodhya with you. Please take us with you. Full of joy, we shall come there and see you getting coronated. We would all love to see that sight of you sitting on the throne with a wonderful crown. All of us would like to come, all the augurs and all the monkeys. When Vibhishana put forth this request, Rama couldn't refuse. So he said, okay, Vibhishana, I can understand your feeling towards me. All of you can come along. And it is always said that it's best to have kinsmen around when you're having any happy event. So if I reach Ayodhya with the host of my friends, everybody would be delighted. All my near and dear ones in Ayodhya, like Bharata and others, would be more than happy to see all of you with me. So please come along. Priyat priyataram labdham yadaham sasuhrijanaha sarvai bhavad bhissahitaha pritim lapsye purim gataha. Bharata and others would be more than happy to see you all, said Rama and called them all to the Pushpaka Vimana. Now, the Pushpaka Vimana was not an ordinary one, it seems. It was expandable in nature. It could accommodate any number of people who boarded onto it. So the Pushpaka Vimana kept on expanding as the monkeys and the augurs started climbing on it one by one. And it is said that it accommodated all of them comfortably. They all sat comfortably without causing obstruction to one another. Thus, with a packed Pushpaka Vimana, Rama started flying towards Ayodhya. In course of their flight to Ayodhya, Rama showed Sita all the places over which they were flying. He started with, "Survey the city of Lanka, my dear Sita." "Lanka meekshasva vaidehi," he said. He particularly told her to see Lanka, it seems, because Lanka had been under the bad influence of Ravana. If Sita would look at Lanka, Sita, the goddess of auspiciousness, would look at Lanka, then all the evil effects on Lanka would be gone and Lanka would stay prosperous forever. And Rama wanted to do this for the sake of Vibhishana. So he specially told Sita to look at Lanka, to cast her glances on Lanka, and she did so. She was shown the Lanka first by Rama. Sita had not seen the city of Lanka before. She was just in the Ashoka Grove all the while. So now she very happily saw the city and glanced it with her cool kataksha. Once this was done, they flew over that place, which was the area of war. So Rama showed her all the places where he had fought with great augurs. He showed Sita the place where Ravana was slain, where Kumbhakarna was defeated by him, and where Lakshmana had killed Indrajit, and so on. He showed Sita all the places where the main augurs were all slain. Once this area was crossed, they moved ahead and reached the place called the Nala Setu, or the bridge. The bridge was built by the monkey chief Nala, and so is called as the Nala Setu. He showed this Nala Setu to Sita, and the Lord with his own words told Sita that this Setu is that one which will wash everybody's sins away. It is supremely sacred. Setu bandha iti khyatam trailokyena cha pujitam etat pavitram paramam mahapataka nashanam. So Rama himself has said that Setu absolves one of all sins. When he showed it to Sita, he said these words. After that, they flew over the Kishkindha kingdom, and Rama told Sita that this is the place where he met Sugriva and where Vali was killed by him. At this place, Sita had a desire, it seems. Sita said, how would it be if all the wives of these monkeys who are traveling with us also come along to see your coronation? They would all be happy, right? And I would also get to spend time with all these people who have made so much of a sacrifice and sent their husbands to fight with you for my sake. Rama obliged and said that, okay, fine, let's land the Pushpaka at Kishkindha for some time, pick up the wives of these monkeys and proceed. And that is exactly what they did. They picked up all the female monkeys from Kishkindha and had them seated in the Pushpaka, which again expanded to accommodate them. And then the Pushpaka started flying again. Then Rama showed her the Mount Rishyamuka, where he had seen Sugriva, and the river Pampa, where he had seen Hanuman for the first time. And then he showed her the hermitage of Shabari and how he saw her practicing virtue and ascend the heaven in front of his eyes. And then he showed her the place where he had killed the demon Kabanda. And then he showed that place from where Sita got abducted, that is Panchavati. The hermitage from where Sita was abducted was still there, it seems. So Sita had a look at that, and somewhere near that she also saw that place where Jatayu had laid down his life for her, and she bowed down to that place, it seems. And then they proceeded further. Now the places where Sita and Rama were there together started appearing, and Sita was cherishing the beautiful memories of her and Rama together in those beautiful places.
Rama was showing her the same places again, and he was also cherishing the same memories. He showed her the delightful and charming river Godavari, and then he showed the place where he had slain Khara and Dushana, and where Sita had come and embraced him. And then he went ahead to show her the hermitage of sage Agastya, sage Sutikshna, sage Sharabhanga, and sage Atri.
All these hermitages were places that they had visited together when they entered the Dandaka forest. Then they came to the hermitage of sage Bharadwaja. Here, Rama thought that he should alight and let the monkeys rest for some time, because they had been traveling for a little time, but they had been traveling very fast. And so, out of concern, Rama thought that the monkeys needed some rest, and so he landed at Bharadwaja's ashrama. But he was worried for Bharata. So he sent Hanuman as his messenger to Bharata this time to convey that he was on his way and was just approaching Ayodhya very soon. Rama also told Hanuman to meet Guha at Sringiberapura on the way and tell him the news of his arrival. Accordingly, Hanuman travelled as fast as the wind, reached Sringiberapura, gave Guha the good news, and proceeded to Nandigrama, where Bharata was living the life of an ascetic and awaiting the return of Rama. Nandigrama is a village in the outskirts of the city of Ayodhya. It is said that Bharata was taking care of the administrative affairs of Ayodhya from there itself, and he had placed the sandals, the paduka of Rama, on the throne of Ayodhya. So Rama had sent Hanuman to this place, to Bharata, and he had told Hanuman something special. Somehow Rama told Hanuman that, see, you go and tell Bharata that I'm coming, I'm on my way back, and you look intently at his reaction, see his body language. I want to see how Bharata actually reacts to this news, because it happens very naturally to people that if one is in power, he does not want to give up that power easily. So if Bharata has been ruling for these 14 years, and if he has by chance attached himself to administration, then I would love to give up the kingdom to him itself. I do not want it back. So please find out if he has any intention of continuing with the administration. Does he really like to do that? He may not tell you in words, but you can observe from his body language if he's really interested. Rama said this, it seems, because this is the true political sense of a king. So Rama wanted to prove that to the world. Rama was playing the role of an ideal human being and an ideal king. So this is how an ideal king would think. He was ready to give up the kingdom for his brother's sake, and he would not even get him wrong if his brother thought of carrying on with the administration. But when Hanuman came and gave this news to Bharata that Rama was on his way back, Bharata was literally mad with joy. It seems he was so overjoyed that he almost fell unconscious. And tears of joy kept flowing out from the eyes of Bharata, and he could no longer wait to see Rama. He immediately went and carried the sandals of Lord Rama on his head and marched towards the ashrama of Bharadwaja in order to meet Rama and bring him back in great pomp and honor. By this time, the people of Ayodhya also got the news of Rama's return. Bharata's messengers went and told all of them in the city, and everybody marched towards Bharadwaja's ashrama to bring back Rama to Ayodhya with all ceremony. Bharata met Rama, fell at his feet, and gave the kingdom back to him, and called him back to Ayodhya. He got a beautiful chariot to drive Rama back home. And when Rama took his seat on the chariot, Bharata took the reins of the chariot and became his charioteer. Shatrughna held the parasol in his hand, and Lakshmana carried a fan. And on the other side stood Vibhishana carrying another white fan. And all of them traveled together along with Rama and Sita into Ayodhya. Once they reached Ayodhya, the preparations for the grand coronation of Rama was going on in full swing. Sage Vasishtha had made all the arrangements for a grand coronation, which was even more carefully arranged than the coronation which was planned 14 years ago. This time Vasishtha took care of each and every aspect and saw to it that he was doing everything at the right time so that this coronation really happens. It is said that Vasishtha requested the monkeys to go and get holy water from 500 sacred rivers. And Jambavan, the king of bears, went and got sacred water from the eastern sea. Rishabha, the monkey, got water from the southern sea. Gavaya, the monkey, got from the western sea. And Hanuman got water from the northern ocean. Thus getting sacred water from all corners of the world, a great coronation of Rama happened with the help of 8 great sages, it seems. Sage Vasishtha, Vamadeva, Jabali, Kashyapa, Katyayana, Suyagna, Gautama and Vijaya. These 8 sages came and consecrated Rama with the sacred water from all these holy rivers and seas. It looked as though it was the coronation of Indra by the 8 Vasus. Abhishinchannaravyagram prasannena sugandhina salilena sahasraksham vasavo vasavam yatha. The entire clan of Rama was present beside him. His own brothers, his friends, great sages and all the citizens of Ayodhya were all present for this wonderful coronation. All the monkeys and the augurs were also completely enjoying this sight. At this time, the wind god Vayu presented Rama with a golden garland consisting of 100 golden lotuses. And again, Indra presented a necklace of pearls to Rama. It is said that this pearl necklace was given by Rama to Sita, and Rama told Sita to give it to anybody whom she wishes to. And Sita had no second thought but to give it to Hanuman, who immediately wore it as the greatest blessing of Sita and Rama. This shows how fond Sita was of Hanuman and how grateful she felt. Hanuman was the connecting thread in the entire story of Ramayana. He always went as a messenger who gave solace to the one who received the message and also to the one who gave the message. He went as a messenger between Sita and Rama twice. Once to the Ashoka Grove and once to get back Sita after Ravana was slain. And then again he went as a messenger to Guha and Bharata to announce the arrival of Rama. Thus anywhere Hanuman went, auspiciousness followed. That is why the very goddess of auspiciousness Sita bestowed this gift on Hanuman so that he could continue to be a symbol of auspiciousness on this earth, because Hanuman would stay on this earth till the story of Ramayana stayed and thus would be a constant sign of auspiciousness. Thus this grand ceremony of coronation of Rama came to an end, and his dear brother-like friends Sugriva and Vibhishana left for their respective kingdoms, and Lord Rama along with Sita Devi and his brothers started ruling the kingdom very, very wisely. How Rama ruled righteously is what we shall see in the next part.